immerse themselves. It's possible that some of you may not be reading your Bible every day or even at all between Sunday services. I'm not trying to embarrass you or make you feel bad. That's what your conscience is for. But just in case, we're going to try to hear at least two readings. And today we're going to go to the first book in the Hebrew Bible, Genesis chapter 4. We'll read the first four verses. Hear the word of the Lord. The Lord said to Abram, "Go from your country, your people, and your father's household to the land I will show you. I will make you into a great nation, and I will bless you. I will make your name great, and you will be a blessing. I will bless those who bless you, and whoever curses you, I will curse. And all peoples on earth will be blessed through you." So Abram went as the Lord had told him, and Lot went with him. Abram was 75 years old when he departed from Haran. And if you want to read more about that, you can go to the 12th chapter, starting at the 4th verse in Genesis. And now from the 4th gospel, a reading that is so often reduced to just one verse, and I want us to hear the totality of it. It's the 3rd chapter, the first 17 verses of the Gospel according to St. John. "Now there was a Pharisee, a man named Nicodemus, who was a member of the Jewish ruling council. He came to Jesus at night and said, 'Rabbi, we know that you are a teacher who has come from God, for no one could perform the signs you were doing if they were not with God.' Jesus replied, 'Very truly I tell you, no one can see the kingdom of God unless they are born again.' 'How can someone be born when they are old?' Nicodemus asked. 'Surely they cannot enter a second time into their mother's womb to be born.' Jesus answered, 'Verily I tell you, no one can enter the kingdom of God unless they are born of water and the Spirit. Flesh gives birth to flesh, but the Spirit gives birth to spirit. You should not be surprised at my saying, you must be born again. The wind blows wherever it chooses. You hear the sound of it, but you do not know where it comes from or where it goes. So it is with everyone who is born of the Spirit.' Nicodemus said to him, 'How can these things be?' Jesus answered him, 'Are you a teacher of Israel, and yet you do not understand these things? Very truly, I tell you, we speak of what we know, and we testify of what we have seen, yet you do not receive our testimony. If I have told you about earthly things and you do not believe, how can you believe if I tell you about heavenly things? No one has ascended into heaven except the one who descended from heaven, the Son of Man. And just as Moses lifted up the serpent in the wilderness, so must the Son of Man be lifted up, that whoever believes in him may have eternal life. For God so loved the world that he gave his only Son, so that everyone who believes in him may not perish, but have eternal life. Indeed, God did not send the Son into the world to condemn the world, but in order that the world might be saved through him. The grass withers, the flower fades, but the word of our God shall stand forever. This is the word of God for the people of God. Thanks be to God. Amen."
Let you in on a little secret about me. If you hadn't figured it out already, I have a lot of questions. I have a lot of questions. They bug me. I think you post on social media ponderables. Ponderisms, that's it. I'm kind of that way. How high really is up? Why is Maxwell House coffee only good to the last drop? And what's wrong with that one last drop? I want to know. Why does the alphabet only begin with A and end with Z? I think we're missing some really good stuff on both ends, if you ask me. And then the biggest one, and I lose sleep over this one. What makes Teflon stick to the pan? Okay, so I have a lot of questions. And sometimes, unlike now, I'm embarrassed to ask them. I don't want to look dumb or uninformed or unsophisticated. So if I ask someone for an answer, I might just ask them in private. Perhaps you've seen that phenomenon in school or after a meeting at church. Anybody have anything they want to say at this meeting? Anybody have anything else? Anything else? Oh, no, we're fine. Gavel the meeting to close, and then you're inundated in the parking lot. I need to ask you about this. Well, what about that? Well, they don't want to ask in public. We're kind of like that. So today we're going to look in the Bible at someone who had a lot. Well, maybe not a lot of questions, but he had one really big question to ask. And he seems to have been reluctant to ask it in public. The man was named Nicodemus, and he asked his question of Jesus. Let us pray. Gracious God, may the words of my mouth and the meditations of each heart here be acceptable unto you, O God, my rock and my redeemer. Amen. Now, the fourth gospel tells us a bit about Nicodemus. Tells us he's a Pharisee. Pharisees were a Jewish sect who believed that righteousness, I'm oversimplifying, but if you want to ask me after the service, I'm going to oversimplify a little bit, but really their definitional viewpoint was the most important thing relative to righteousness was a literal adherence to Torah, the law of Moses, the first five books. To use a term that's referred to our Constitution, I think it would be fair to say that Pharisees were strict constructionalists. And in a way, there's 613 laws of the Jewish law. There's not 10 commandments, there's really 613. And if I religiously, another adverb I can't use the rest of the time, but an adverb, if I religiously adhere to 215 of them, I'm still kind of below, like 30% here, but anyway, 213, but somebody else, Rod, does 275, and Merle, 450, I think it's a little more than that, but anyway, just neither here nor there. I'm not as righteous then as Rod or Merle. You could kind of stratify this. So that's who Nicodemus was. He was also an important, influential member of the community. In short, he's a prominent person. And I suspect that the question he's asking Jesus may have been one that he was asked, and he was like, what do they say, when in doubt, mumble? Let me go find out, because I'm not sure. But with this question, he does something extraordinary. He drops in on Jesus late at night to ask Jesus a question. Just drops in on Jesus late at night. Who doesn't like somebody to drop in late at night? Yeah, anyway. Mind you, he asked Jesus very nicely and politely, perhaps in part to apologize for disturbing him at this very late or perhaps early hour. He says, Rabbi, we know that you're a teacher who has come from God. That's always a good thing you can say to me if you're knocking on my door at, say, 2 in the morning. Pastor, we know that you're a teacher who has come from God. I still don't recommend knocking on the door. You could probably wait till the next morning or send me an email. But if necessary, that's a nice way to do it. For no one can do these signs that you do apart from the presence of God. True. There you go. And Jesus seems to read Nicodemus's mind. I was a big fan way back of MASH, the TV show. And remember, Radar would answer questions before they were asked. And it made for rather clever dialogue back and forth. Well, here's what Jesus says to Nicodemus. Very truly, I tell you, no one can see the kingdom of God without being born from above. So Nicodemus, maybe rocked back on his heels just a little bit, asked Jesus then that deep, thoughtful, provocative question that Jesus sort of just answered for him. How can anyone be born after having grown old? Can one enter a second time into the mother's womb and be born? See, Nicodemus was asking Jesus to explain something that he had said previously and basically just said to him then. He was asking him to explain being born again or being born. It's a very good question. It's an even more interesting question if you take it literally, perhaps as a Pharisee would be inclined to do. Another show I loved to watch was Home Improvement. How many of y'all like Home Improvement? I think of it every time I'm working with contact cement in the garage, in the workshop, because on that show, poor Tim the tool man would always end up glued to something thanks to contact cement. Well, on one episode, and I cannot remember his wife's name. What was Tim's wife's name? Jill, thank you. Good. Thank you. I didn't have to come to you in the parking lot or late at night. Jill, it's Jill's birthday, and Tim and Al need to go buy her something for her birthday, and she doesn't want, I don't know why, you know, a table saw, you know, combination square, a dado blade, whatever. She wants something ladyish. So they go to the women's clothing section, and guys, how many of you are with me? It's a daunting, scary place to go. And they go to the scariest part. You know what I'm talking about. They're in the lingerie department, and they're trying to pick out something appropriate. And they're looking at the sizes, which make no sense to me at all, except the lower the number, the smaller, the bigger the number, the taller. Are you with me, guys? So they're looking at something, and I don't know, it was an 8 or a 12 or something, and Tim looks at Al and like, what do you think? Is that inches? What? So Al pops off his tape off his belt and pulls it out and is sitting there next to this camisole or whatever. Silly, right? Silly, right? See, Al and Tim are trying to reconcile an irreconcilable size with inches and whatever. They're thinking like guys about things that guys really shouldn't be thinking about. I'm a pastor. I'm telling you, you really shouldn't be thinking about that. Anyway, truth of the matter is, simply put, without going too much into that class that we took when we were like 12 years old and they had the old 16-millimeter projector and the very embarrassed coach teaching, one cannot physically re-enter their mother's womb after being a grown-up. It's not possible. And just like Al and Tim, Nicodemus is confused. Guys, we live confused, don't we? Yeah, we're good at that. We even have that guy confused look, you know, that I think my father, I honestly think my father's face may have been fused that way around our house because he'd come home and it's like, my mother was, you know, hey, get over here. But he's, you know. So Nicodemus is confused, but there's more to this than meets our 21st century eyes. So if you want to put your tape measure back on your belt, go combination square away. Let me tell you a couple of things about it. First, the setting is just perfect, particularly if you understand how the fourth evangelist, how St. John wrote. John was a bipolar writer, and I'm not saying he needed his lithium. I'm saying that he wrote in terms of two extremes. And you saw this all the time. It begins with the true light coming into the world. Light, dark, good, evil, death, life, sin, forgiveness. Everything is kind of counterbalanced against each other. Some people have said it even echoes Zoroastrianism. I don't know. I didn't study enough Zoroastrianism. I'm a Christian. But I can say that darkness was an important point to John. Night signified sin. It signified evil. It signified separation from God, because in God's true light, Jesus Christ, signified death. We can see a bit of that significance as we look at this cross of candles and the Advent wreath, the coming of light and the going of light. Second thing I want to let you know about, when you understand the setting late at night, it also could be in that setting too, you know, a sinister element. Because it wasn't really until the 20th century when they got good street lights, and even some places you don't want to go after dark, do you? Avenue B. No, you don't want to get out. Our backyard. No. There are places in this world you don't want to go in the dark. And we all know that there are monsters under our beds at night. I mean, we know that. Anyway, that's easier. The second thing is there's some wonderful wordplay going on here. Wordplay that we don't see because we're reading a translation and we're reading it 2,000 years later. John, like all the books in the New Testament, was originally written in Greek. And John was actually written in a fairly easy to read Greek. It's not, 1 John is the primer, it's the easiest, but John isn't bad. You see, Nicodemus and Jesus are using the same word. They are using the same word differently. The word in Greek is anothen. There is no parallel to this word in English, in any other language that we know of. Anothen means again or from above. So when it says you must be born anothen, Jesus and Nicodemus can talk past each other. Jesus, when he says you must be born again anothen, is talking, or born from above, is talking spiritually, theologically, speaking in a less than literal, physical way, whereas Nicodemus is hearing it meaning again. So Nicodemus misses the spiritual, theological message, and he is concerned not about the depth of spirituality, not about the rebirth of Christ in our heart. He's thinking elbow room and head room. He's thinking very physical. So Nicodemus has his tape measure, whereas Jesus has the cross. And they just are like two ships passing in the night. And the last thing I want you to know about this is this passage is about, and it's about transformation. See, it's not a Greek word study. It's not about the word play. It's not really even necessarily about the setting. But taken as a whole, it's about transformation. It is about coming in from the dark with your question. Coming into the presence of the one true light and being changed. See where I'm coming from? Nicodemus and Jesus can spar like fencers over the meaning of the word anothen. But ultimately, it's about an ordinary person who comes to Jesus in the dark experiences the light and is changed. Now, it does take a little bit of time. Nicodemus doesn't immediately have the light bulb go off in a eureka moment. He repeatedly misunderstands Jesus' theological meaning, implementing his own ergonomic one instead. And Jesus even seems to prod him a little bit again. What's Jesus trying to do? Jesus is trying to change Nicodemus as he's trying to change us. Nicodemus is just kind of like my father. I'm not getting this. Jesus is having to work on it. Jesus says, are you a teacher of Israel and yet you don't understand these things? Prod, prod, prod. Jesus was calling on him to think and believe beyond the premise of the question he came to ask and to look at things from a whole new perspective. Let the scales fall off his eyes. And to that end, Jesus shares that great, powerful, transformational discourse that ends with, it begins with, very truly I tell you, we speak of what we know and testify to what we have seen, yet you do not receive our testimony. If I have told you about earthly things and you do not believe, how will you believe if I tell you about heavenly things? We know Peter had that problem, didn't he? When Jesus asked the disciples, who do the people say I am? And some say, he's Elijah. Some say, who do you say I am? Well, you're the Messiah, the Son of the living God. Well, obviously, bing, bing, right answer. But then Simon Peter doesn't get the answer. Because when Jesus starts talking about what it means to be the Messiah and be crucified and died and be raised again, Simon Peter says, whoa, boss, we're getting off here. We're talking about scary downer stuff. This will never get new members to our church. And Jesus says, get behind me, Satan. Because you're thinking of earthly things. You need to be thinking of heavenly things. So Nicodemus, you need to be transformed. Stop thinking in terms of earth creature. Start thinking in terms of a disciple of the Son of God. For God so loved the world. Here is a transformational message that ought to resonate with all of us. For God so loved the world that he gave his only Son, that whoever believes in him may not perish but have eternal life. Simply put, Nicodemus came to Jesus covertly in the night seeking information, and Jesus offered him transformation. The whole course, not only of his thinking, but more importantly of his life, and we'll talk a little bit more about that here in a moment, was changing before his eyes. The light was going on inside of himself at this dark hour. His world was changing. How many of you all are old enough to remember The Wide World of Sports, the TV show that was on for eons, and it's probably been off for eons? It began, if you'll remember, with this rather profound speech about the thrill of victory and the agony of defeat. And on that, you see a guy cratering down a ski jump. Skis going, you know, everywhere, and he's tumbling in snow and looks like limbs and everything else, crash landing for the agony of defeat. But the truth is, the Slovenian skier, a guy named Vinko Bogataj, I guess is how you pronounce it, there's more to the story. See, he was in good form as he started down the slope, and you see the beginning of the video, he's doing all right. And then for some inapparent reason, he craters down the ski slope. Now, what you don't know is that he chose to fall rather than finish the jump. Why? As he explained later, the jump surface had become too fast. And midway down the ramp, he realized that if he completed the jump, he would land on the level ground beyond the downslope, and that would have been fatal. So he chose to crash. And surprisingly, he suffered no more than a headache from his tumble. Sometimes we have to change our course because where we're heading is dangerous. And sometimes that change can be dramatic and can even be painful. Well, see, Nicodemus was having a time of change. Jesus tells Nicodemus that he's facing a fatal landing if he doesn't change direction. But Nicodemus only knows one way, and that's the way of earth. It's the only way any of us knows. Suddenly Jesus appears on the scene speaking of heaven and being born again, being born anew. And Nicodemus is confused. See, Jesus is challenging our way of thinking. He's challenging our way, our path, with something called discipleship. We need to stop our own fatalistic and sinful path and start following Jesus. And that's transformational. John Wesley called it sanctification, becoming more godlike. A path of grace. As we move from proverbial darkness into light, just as Nicodemus did. It's about growth. It's about change. It's about movement. But it demands things of us, things we just might not be willing to do. For we like to play it safe, don't we? There was a jazz club many years ago in New Orleans. It was a small club, and in the corner of the club sat a dilapidated old piano. And all of the jazz artists complained about this antiquated instrument. The piano players dreaded it. The vocalists dreaded singing with it. And all the combos who played the club wished they could bring their own piano. Now you can bring, you know, a digital, but back then you couldn't. Just like they could bring their own saxophone and trombone and all that, trumpet. And after years of listening to the complaints of the jazz musicians about the piano, the owner of the club decided to do something about it. He painted the piano. Father Henry Nouwen, one of the great spiritual writers, I encourage you to read some of the things he's written. Father Nouwen, the late Father Nouwen, reflecting on Nicodemus, said, "I love Jesus, but I want to hold on to my own friends, even if they don't lead me closer to Jesus." Sound like anybody you know? "I love Jesus, but I want to hold on to my own independence, even when that independence brings me no real freedom. I love Jesus, but I don't want to lose the respect of my professional colleagues, even though I know that their respect doesn't make me grow spiritually. I love Jesus, but I don't want to give up my writing plans, travel plans, speaking plans, even when these plans are often more to my glory than the glory of God." See, upon reflection, Father Nouwen realized that he wasn't all that different from Nicodemus. He wrote, "So I am like Nicodemus, who came by night and said safe things about Jesus to his colleagues. Even a great Christian like Father Nouwen sometimes is content to just paint the old piano." There's an element of Nicodemus in all of us, you know that. It's easier sometimes to play it safe and keep Jesus off in the distance than to call him the Lord of our life. We need to know, however, that we cannot always put him off. Nicodemus came to him playing it safe, and Jesus changed him. Remember Jesus' challenge to Nicodemus. It's in the Gospel of John, not just as information, but it's speaking to us too. "Very truly I tell you that no one can see the kingdom of God without being born from above. Not you, not me, not any of us." We must change. And God will work in and through us to effect that change if we'll let it happen. And not just our paint job, but our hearts. For you see, to be born again means something. It's not wordplay, it means something. It means to come alive to God's Word. Are we reading it every day? Think about that. To be born from above, to be born again, means to come alive to love. And not just that romantic, mushy kind of love, but the love that works to be a bringer of God's kingdom into this world. Remember the words of Micah, do justice, love mercy, and walk humbly with your God. That's what love looks like. And to be born from above means to come alive to eternal life, to take it seriously enough to live our lives based on its truth. We can just say, hey, I believe it. I'll put a bumper sticker on my car, a little fish on the back. I'll listen to Christian radio. But man, I'm going to live my life by building up treasure for myself, by self-aggrandizement, by doing the things that take care of myself. I got to put me number one, don't I? Who's going to look out for me? Well, all of a sudden we've forgotten eternal life and the gift of God. Nicodemus, brothers and sisters, was changed. He became an archetype, an example of what discipleship looks like. It's movement from visitor. This looks interesting. To follower. Remember what follower means in the Jewish tradition. To walk so close to your master that you are covered in the dust of his sandals. And then if we are following that closely, we move to that third phase, which is witness. It worked for Nicodemus. A nighttime visitor, Nick at night. To Nick changed. To Nick the disciple. How do we know? Because in the 19th chapter of the Gospel of John, 15 chapters later, 16 chapters, I guess it is, whatever, we're told this. The setting is the day of Jesus' crucifixion. He is dead on the cross, and as you know, being crucified dead, you don't get any more dead than that. John writes, later, Joseph of Arimathea asked Pilate for the body of Jesus. Now Joseph was a disciple of Jesus, but secretly because he feared the Jewish leaders. With Pilate's permission, he came and took the body away. He was accompanied by Nicodemus, the man who had visited Jesus at night. Nicodemus brought a mixture of myrrh and aloes, about 75 pounds. So the man who was afraid to ask Jesus a question in public in the daytime went and confronted a butcher named Pontius Pilate and asked for the body of a crucified traitor. He's not scared anymore, is he? Maybe he's taking eternal life seriously. And then what does he do? He takes 75 pounds of aloes and myrrh. Modern day price for that, around $6,000. Much more in Jesus' day. Why is he giving up such a fortune? Because he's taking eternal life seriously. He has been born anew, born from above. And taking Jesus' body, the two of them wrapped it with the spices in strips of linen. This was in accordance with Jewish burial customs. At the place where Jesus was crucified, there was a garden. And in the garden was a new tomb in which no one had ever been laid. And because it was the Jewish day of preparation, and since the tomb was nearby, they laid Jesus there. Friends, we all have questions. Jesus is the answer if we will follow him on the path of discipleship. In the name of the Father, Son, and Holy Spirit. Amen.